Starting with SA330, it is basically in a standard auditing which is following SA315. In SA315, we had assessed some risk, and in SA330, we are giving a response to the assessed risk. So the scope, starting with the scope and objective of this essay, that basically, as I told you, it follows your SA315. We'll say that after assessing the risk of material misstatement, MM means material misstatement, which would be in accordance with SA315. Auditor should did. I'm just saying. Your auditor should determine the overall response to, this is a single sentence. I'm just breaking down into three sub sentences so that you can easily understand this. Auditor should determine the overall response to address the risk of material misstatement. Risk of material misstatement. MM means material misstatement. So after he has assessed the risk of material misstatement, the auditor has to determine the overall response. How is going to respond to this assessed risk? What are the further audit procedures, designing or determining the further audit procedures to address these risk is going to be covered under SA 330. So for this purpose, that is to address this risk. The auditor should design and perform further audit procedure. To respond to those risks. For addressing these risks, for taking actions so that risk can be minimized, etc. We are going to design and then perform further audit procedures that's going to respond to those risks. Now, coming to the ultimate objective, it is quite similar to SA 315, where we said that the ultimate objective was to reduce the audit risk to an acceptably low level. Although in this case, it's an extension because we are responding to that. So we'll write that to reduce the audit risk to an acceptably low level, at the same time by obtaining sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. So the ultimate objective is going to be to reduce audit risk. AR refers to the audit risk to an acceptably low level. This was the objective under SA315. Now we are responding how? By obtaining sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. S means sufficient, A means appropriate, AE means audit evidence. So this is the ultimate objective of this essay 330. Now a summary of what we are going to cover in this essay. First, we will be covering overall response. This would be the first thing. Then we'll move on to the audit procedures that will include the nature, timing and extent. Then we have test of controls. Then we have substantive procedures. Then evaluating the sufficiency and appropriateness of audit evidence. And then at the end, as in almost all the essays, we are going to document. That is what the auditor has to document, which will include your overall response. I will be covering this along with the essay. Now, first part we have, you can see over here, that first we have overall response. So I've written some points for overall response to save some time. See, the overall response to address the assessed risk of material misstatement at financial statement level may include these points, which are sub-points I've written down. So first of all is to maintain professional skepticism. Skepticism means a doubtful. Auditor should be doubtful over or should be vigilant over transactions occurring in the environment of the organization. He should have a doubtful mind, although as per a famous case of Kingston Cotton Mills, it was ruled that the auditor is not a bloodhound, he's a watchdog. Watchdog means that bloodhound means that he has to be after frauds. I mean, he has to search and identify fraud. This is not the objective of the auditor. But he's a watchdog, that if he has any kind of hint that there might be a fraud, he has to perform additional procedures. So this way he says that he should maintain professional skepticism. If he's getting a particular hint about that there might be a misstatement, he should extend his audit procedures. He should have a doubtful mind that if there is a doubt that there might be a misstatement, he should go for it. I mean, try to identify the complete misstatements. So maintaining professional skepticism, the auditor has to encourage his team to maintain professional skepticism while obtaining audit evidences. So the auditor should encourage his team to maintain professional skepticism while obtaining audit evidence, that is A.E. Assigning, then the second point is assigning more experienced staff or those with specialized skills. Because see, we have identified a risk. There is a risk because this is S330. We are responding to the risk which we have identified as per S315. So when there is a risk, we require to assign more experienced staff or with the specialized skills. Let me give you an example. One of my friend was working with the big one of the big four, that is Ernst & Young. I guess you must have heard about that. Ernst & Young, when he was doing his article chip, in the whole 3 years, he had to do just one object. He had just one area, that was accounts receivables. In the balance sheet, there would be an item on the debit side, account receivables. In the profit and loss account, there would be bad debt. 3 years, he had to do the same thing. Although it can be monotonous, but now he's a guy who is always called for. If there's anything, any problem as far as accounts receivable is concerned, he has the one, because he has dealt with so many cases in accounts receivable that he has specialized skills in this. And so although it might not give you experience of other fields, but as far as the organizations which require person for accounts receivable, this is a big field, because accounts receivable, if you're working with a big four that like Ernst & Young, your clients would be like BMW, or BMW is a client of, I guess, PwC. So they would be very large clients, and their accounts receivable will be in crores of rupees. So this in itself would be a big issue for these clients. So he has a specialized skill. So if risk has been assessed as far as accounts receivable is concerned, he would be the one who would be leading the team now, because he has an experience of 3 years just in accounts receivables. So we assign more experienced staff or those with specialized skills. Then changes to the audit procedures. The auditor can make, if, because we have identified this, the auditor can may make changes to the audit procedure. For example, he may shift from a period end examination to, oh sorry, inter, from interim period to period end examination. That is, see, for this is the financial year starting from 1st of April to 31st of March. Earlier he used to audit in between, like he would come over here and examine. So in this case, he can examine only this particular thing. But when he's coming at the period end, he can examine the whole thing. He can examine each and every account which has already been closed, so there won't be any more transactions to it. So this way, he can change the audit procedure, because now there has been a risk identified. So making changes, or we can say auditor may make changes to the audit procedures. For example, performing audit procedures at period end instead of interim date. Now we have a small case when the control environment is weak. Now what the auditor can do? Auditor has to conduct more audit procedures at period end rather than your interim period. Because again, if you are auditing over here, the controls are very weak. There's an increased possibility that there might be a misstatement in this particular area. So when the control environment is weak, the auditor should conduct more audit procedures. More, because it doesn't mean that you cannot, you do not have to perform any kind of audit procedures in between. You should do this. This may be a kind of a surprise visit or a surprise check or unannounced check that you didn't tell the auditor, the client, that I would be coming on maybe, say for example, 26th of December to audit your cash receipts or inventories. You just straight away go over there and examine them, and if you are able to find any misstatement, qualify your audit report if it is very material and pervasive. I've discussed in this in SA 700 series. Now, auditor should conduct more audit procedures at period end rather than at an interim date. Now, if you have assessed some risk, you may increase the number of locations to be included in your audit scope. How? For example, you are auditing inventories. There are many organizations in my Delhi itself that they have so many warehouses in Delhi itself. I mean, there are so many branches in Delhi. So if you have to audit the inventories in Delhi, you may have to go to 7 or 8 places. So earlier you thought that you would be covering 3 or 4 out of them, but now since the risk has been assessed, there is a risk of material misstatement. Now he may have to go and visit all 8 or at least 7 or 6 or 7 locations. So you may increase the number of locations to be included in audit scope, and increase the number of locations could be increased in the states as well. Now, the auditor may use two kinds of approach. One is substantive approach, the other one is combined approach. Substantive approach and the other is combined approach. Now, substantive approach will emphasize only on substantive procedures, which emphasize on substantive procedures. But the combined approach is going to test, which tests your controls. It is definitely going to test your controls along with, it's also going to perform your performance of substantive. It's also going to perform your substantive procedure, because this is combined. It is going to include your substantive procedures. The combined approach includes a test of controls along with performance of substantive procedures. Then we have a statement that auditor should design and perform further. This is a single sentence I'm writing, breaking down into four sentences. Further audit procedures that are responsive to the addressed. Sorry, responsive to. I always get confused in this. Assessed risk of material misstatement. That is, auditor should design and perform further audit procedures. You have to design, and designing is not going to serve the purpose. You also have to perform them. Perform the audit procedures, which are further audit procedures, because you have identified some risk. Now you have to perform additional audit procedures that are responsive to the assessed risk of material misstatement. They are specifically designed for assessing this, responding to this address, assessed risk of material misstatement. The risk you have assessed, you are responding to them by using further audit procedure. And at the relevant assertion level, assertion, I've told you in many of these standards that assertion means any kind of declarations made by the management. For example, the same example, if there's a balance sheet, there's a machinery in that particular balance sheet, this is an assertion or a declaration by the management that we own a machinery, and when it is valued at 50 lakh rupees, it says that it is a declaration, or it's a assertion that the machinery is valued at 50 lakh, and another assertion that it is valued at written down value. So everything is presumed and assumed regarding assertion. So these are responsive to assess the risk of material misstatement at the relevant assertion level. Further audit procedure will be designed for the relevant assertion level. Now, in case of small entities, there's always a case in these standards on auditing for small entities. See, in case of small entities, they won't be having many controls. If you take an example of a particular business near your home place, you find that they're just doing the business as it is. I mean, they do not have any kind of active procedures. So small entities may not be having control activities. For this reason, there's no use of performing or examining the controls. Your focus should always be on substantive procedures. Substantive procedures is regarding the transaction or account balances, because they do not have controls. No use of performing test of controls. No use of testing the controls. But substantive procedure has to be performed. So in case of small entities, they may not be having control activities. For this reason, your auditors further audit procedure, this is F for further, A for audit, P for procedures, are likely to be primarily substantive procedures, and we can say there won't be any test of controls. So we have covered the overall response. We've covered overall response. Now we are moving on to audit procedures, that is the nature, timing and extent. So audit procedure, nature, timing and extent. The first thing is nature. Audit procedure will, in this we are going to discuss the nature of the audit procedures, that is your what kind of audit procedures that you have to perform, whether you have to observe or inspect something or re-perform something or recalculate something or you inspect something or inquire something. So these are the nature of the audit procedures. It can be substantive in nature, it can be compliance or test of controls. And then we have your timing. Timing means that at what time you are auditing these accounts. I mean, for which period you are auditing the accounts. And then we'll have extended the depth of audit, that is how many the sample size, how what should be a sample size, how many controls you have to audit, etc., etc. So starting with the nature. So nature of further audit procedures refers to their purpose, refer to their purpose and type. And the purpose, we can have a test of controls. I'm going to discuss these two in detail, test of controls, and then we'll have substantive procedures. In the type, you can say that is, i.e. refers to that is. It can be recalculation, as I give you all the examples already. Recalculation, reperformance. It can be your analytical procedures, that is examining of ratios, trends, etc. Trends, analytical procedures. You can go for inspection, you can go for observation, you can go for inquiry, or you may go for confirmation. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Yes, 7 or 5. Yeah, so these are your types of the nature. Basically includes purpose and type. Purpose may be of examining the controls, or it may be substantive procedure, that is examining transaction account balances, etc. The type could be, you may do any of these procedures or the techniques. So then we have a statement that if the auditor has already assessed the risk as per SA 350, now we are on to SA 330. If the assessed risk is very high, then there's just a small statement that more reliable and relevant. With the audit evidence you are obtaining, it should be more reliable and relevant is the audit evidence. More reliable and relevant is the audit evidence sought. That is, you are asking for this, sought by auditor from substantive procedures. That is, when you're performing the substantive procedures, your objective is to obtain more reliable and relevant audit evidence, because you know that the risk is very high. So this was the nature. Now we're moving on to the timing. I've written down the timing because it would have taken me a long time than that case. See, and it's a very, very easy. You can pause the video now and read what I've written here over here. You may pause the video now. 3, 2, 1. I hope that you pause the video and have read this. Now see, it refers as to when audit procedures are performed of the period. When you're performing the audit procedure, it may be in interim, that is within the accounting period, or it may be at the period end. It may be in 2013, 14, or 14, 15. This is known as timing. Or date to which audit evidence applies, that is the period for which the audit evidence applies. For example, it may be for 2013, 14, 14, 15. So this is to which the audit evidence is applying. Then, so this statement has been covered. This is very general and very easy topic, you can say. Auditor may perform test of controls or substantive procedures. These are the two nature of audit, nature of your audit procedures. Test of controls or substantive procedures. Let's see, in this, test of controls and substantive procedures. The auditor may perform test of controls or substantive procedure at an interim date or at period date. Period date means at the end of the period. Now there is a statement that higher the risk of material misstatement. If the material misstatement is very high, the auditor may decide it is more effective to perform substantive procedures nearer to or at the period end rather than to perform rather than at an earlier date. That is, if the risk is very high. First of all, we have written that if the risk is very high, we are going to sort. More reliable, we need more reliable and relevant audit evidence. Okay, in this case also, if the risk is very high, because now we are concerned with timing, when should we perform the audit procedures? If the risk is very high, we may go for performing the substantive procedures at nearer to or at the period end, because in this case we will be covering, for example, this is the your period under audit, 1st of April, 31st of March. If you perform it nearer to this, you can go for all the audit up to this. All right, so therefore we should perform the procedures nearer to or at the period end rather than at an earlier date. Okay, rather than performing it over here, we should perform it over here. All right, Then, or to perform audit procedure unannounced. This is a surprise visit. You do not tell him that I'll be coming for auditing your receipts or cash book, etc., or inventories, etc., or physical examination of your machineries, etc. But you straight away go over there without announcing or without telling him, which is unpredictable at an unpredictable time, right? So this is what the auditor has to do as far as timing is concerned when the risk is very high. But there is a contrary statement as well. Contrary means opposing this. I mean, if this does not hold true for all the experts, some experts say that you need to perform it over here, but other experts say that if you perform over here, they have a valid point to make, that if you're performing it nearer to or at period end, for example, a misstatement occurred over here, there was a misstatement, and maybe for example in the month of June, so April, May, June, in 3 months of the starting of the financial year, there was a misstatement. Now you're auditing it on 31st of March. What happens? It has been 9 months since the misstatement has not been disclosed. If you would have performed it at an interim date, for example, and in July or maybe in August, you would have earlier identified this misstatement. So this is something which is contrary or opposing this rule. So I've written down this as a contrary argument, that is opposing argument to above. What we have discussed above, contrary statement is this. Performing audit procedure before period end may assist the auditor in identifying significant matters at an early stage. You can identify those matters at an early stage of audit and consequently resolving them. You have identified them and resolved them with the help of your management, with the assistance of management. You tell the management that there's a misstatement over here. You ask the management, and with the management, you may resolve the matter at an early stage. If the misstatement is in June and you are auditing in July, within a month you can resolve the matter. Otherwise it would take you 9 months if you're auditing in 31st of March. By developing an effective audit approach to address such matters, okay, you have developed an effective audit approach with the assistance of management to address such matters. Such matters means the are identifying significant these matters, right? So this is a contrary statement. So we've covered timing, which was very easy, although now we're on to the extent. As I told you, extent means the depth or the number of audit procedures, you can say, number of evidences you need, or number of items to be examined, or number of control activities to be examined. This is going to be covered in extent. So extent, it refers to the quantity of a specific procedure to be performed. Right, quantity, this is refers to the quantity, how many what quantity of substantive procedures you have to perform. That is, in case of substantive approach, let me give you some examples. Examples can be the sample size. This is the extent. Larger your sample size, more is the extent. Or number of observations. In case of control activities, you observe the controls. Number of observations of a control activity. Right, this is going to determine your extent. Now, determining the extent of audit procedures is a jungle, that what should be the sample size, or how number of observations of which of a control activity you have to observe. This is something which is not going to be told to you as an auditor by the management. Management has no interference in this. This is the judgment or a professional judgment of the auditor. So judgment of auditor, but after considering, he's going to consider three factors. It is judgment of the auditor. After considering, he is going to consider three factors. The first is materiality. The item is material. Go for more. Increase the sample size, because this is a material item. Increase the number of observation, because it is a very important item. Then assessed, because this is responding to the assessed risk. So higher the risk of material misstatement, you need to increase the sample size and the number of observation. Assessed risk of material misstatement. And then the third thing is the degree of assurance that the auditor plans to obtain. For example, if there are 1000 items and the auditor is choosing a sample of maybe 50 items, the assurance that the auditor will get is very low, because by examining 50 items, you are giving an opinion about 1000 items. It cannot be. It may be possible that you may not have come across some kind of misstatement which was there, because a sample size of 50 is very low. So if you want to obtain more assurance, you need to increase the sample size. You should examine maybe 400, 500 items out of 1000 items. That is, every second item he has to audit, the assurance will increase. If he examines 100, all 100%, that is 1000 items, assurance is 100%. Maybe if there's not an error committed by the auditor, in that case only. So 100% assurance is always a tough thing to get. And same would be the case with the number of observation of control activities, that how deeply you are examining the controls, etc. Now we are starting with the test of controls. Just let me change. So we have covered the audit procedures, nature, timing and extent. Now we are on to the test of controls, right? Alright, so first of all, test of controls, we are going to cover the definition of test of controls. So I'm breaking down it into three parts. The first part of this is a single sentence though. This is an audit procedure. Alright, this is an audit procedure, test of controls, because I told you that audit procedure has two parts. One is the test of controls and the other one is your substantive approach. So this is an audit procedure which is designed to evaluate something. What? The operating effectiveness, that the controls are operating effectively, operating effectiveness of controls. It is an audit procedure which is designed to evaluate the operating effectiveness of controls. How effective the control is in preventing, that is, how effective it is in preventing your material misstatement, because the first thing we want to have is prevent material misstatement, that do they do not occur. Preventing is, we always say preventing is better than cure. Preventing means that it doesn't occur at all. Preventing or detecting. If you cannot prevent it, at least detect it. If the control cannot prevent your misstatements, it should detect them. And detecting will serve no purpose if it is not corrected. So preventing or detecting and correcting. Because if it has prevented, there is no use of correcting. Preventing or detecting and correcting what? The material misstatement at the assertion level. This is the definition of test of controls. Right? Now we are going to have a statement regarding audit for this control, test of controls, that when the auditor is going to perform audit procedures, test of control, auditor should perform TOC, means test of controls. The auditor should perform test of controls when, I'm giving you two situations where the test of control is required to be done. See, this is a response to the risk. We have already assessed some risk. Now, in assessing those risks, if we had an expectation, if we had assumed, the auditor has assumed that the controls are operating effectively, he has to perform, after assessing the risk, the operating effectiveness, he has to determine the operating effectiveness of controls after that. That is, if he has assumed that the controls are effective when he was assessing the risk, if so there was a stage one was that he was assessing the risk, and the stage two is test of controls, right? In the stage one, he was assessing the risk. If in the stage one, he has assumed that the test the controls are effective, he has to go to the test of controls, to the stage two, to test the controls. So the first thing then the auditor has to perform the test of controls is that the auditor's risk assessment includes expectation of what? Of operating effectiveness of controls, that is, he assumed that the controls are effective. Risk assessment includes expectation of operating effectiveness of controls. The second thing, when the auditor has to go for test of control, is that there are two procedures. One is substantive procedure. If the auditor thinks that the substantive procedure cannot or do not provide sufficient and appropriate audit evidence, you need to go to the test of controls. If the substantive procedures are not able to perform are not able to obtain evidences, and go for the test of controls. The second situation where we have to perform test of control is that the substantive procedures alone do not provide. Now S means sufficient, A means appropriate, A means audit evidence. Sufficient and appropriate audit evidence, again at the relevant assertion level, and in that case test of controls has to be performed. Now timing, that is when you have to perform the test of controls. Okay, so it may be for a particular time or it may be throughout the period. For the particular time you're testing the particular controls which were effective for that particular time, for example, a basic example just to learn this thing is that when something like a theft occurs in a shop, CCTVs act as a control over the employees. So what he does, he examines the CCTV footage only of that particular day. He doesn't examine of the whole previous years. So for that particular time, or it may be throughout the period. My handwriting is very bad. I'm sorry about that. For the particular time or throughout the period, right? This is the timing. Now there's a case. Auditor obtains audit evidence about the operating effectiveness of controls during an interim period. Now what the auditor has to do. See, if he's obtaining the audit, see. Let me draw. Let's see. This is the financial year, 1st of April to the 31st of March. If he has performed the test of controls over here, he has obtained audit evidence till here. Now what the auditor has to do, because see, auditor obtains audit evidence about the operating effectiveness of controls during an interim period. Interim period could be this. Now what the auditor has to do is for this remaining period, he has to consider any changes. This triangle refers to changes which has occurred in the controls because he has audited till now. So over here, he has to consider significant changes to those controls. At the same time, he has to determine or obtain additional audit evidence. So he has to determine that whether any additional audit evidence is required to be obtained for a remaining period. That is, for this period, what kind of audit evidence he requires because he has audited till now. So two things he has to keep in mind. First is what significant changes have occurred. And the other thing, what audit evidence needs to be obtained. So auditor obtains audit evidence about the operating effectiveness of controls during an interim period. So the auditor shall, what he has to do, the auditor shall consider. The first thing is he has to consider the significant changes to those controls. He has to consider significant changes to those controls and then determining the additional audit evidence to be obtained. What audit evidence he has to obtain for the remaining period. Right, I hope you have understood this. So this was regarding your a small case. Now we're moving on to another case. If the audit evidence obtained in previous audit, for example, he was auditing the accounts for 2013-14, now he's in 2014-15. He had obtained some audit evidences in the previous audit. What he has to do? He shall establish the continuing relevance of that evidence. In this particular financial year as well, he should see that if it is relevant till now in 2014-15, because the evidence was obtained in 2013-14. So he should establish the continuing relevance of that evidence by obtaining audit evidence about whether significant changes. He has to obtain audit evidence that whether changes in those controls have occurred, whether those changes have been changed. So he has to obtain audit evidence regarding that have occurred subsequent to that previous audit. After this, so this is the your financial year 2013-14. This is your financial year 2014-15. You obtain audit evidence over here. Now in this period, whenever you are auditing, if you are using the audit evidence, you have to consider that whether it is relevant in this period as well, if any changes have occurred after this in this period, has any changes occurred in these controls which you audited in the previous year. So there can be two cases: either these controls which are operating over here have changed, or they have not changed. If they have changed, the controls which you audited in the previous year have changed, the auditor shall test the controls in the current audit. Simple. If they have changed, test the controls, because they are no more the same which you audited in the previous year. So you have to test those controls. But the main thing is that if they have not changed. Now this essay says that at least in 3 years, every control should be audited once. Every control should be examined once. How? In every year when you're coming, examine some controls. For example, if there are 30 controls that have been audited, in 2014-15, you come and audit 10 controls. In 15-16, you come and audit 10 controls again. And in 16-17, you come again and audit 10 more controls. So in 3 years, these 30 controls have been audited. And you will repeat the same thing in the next period. And those controls which have changed, for example, if for your 3 out of these controls have changed, you have to examine this in the adjacent period, in the absolutely next period, alright? Because those have changed. Now, so in this case, the SSA give you a time of 3 years. If they have not changed, the auditor shall test controls at least once in every third audit. And every third audit, you should audit at least once and shall test some controls each audit. Whenever you're coming, examine some controls so that you can go for all the controls have been audited at least once in 3 years. So this is regarding this model case if you're using the audit evidence obtained in the previous audit. Now you're evaluating the operating effectiveness of controls. The auditor should consider evaluating operating effectiveness of controls. The auditor should consider whether misstatements that have been detected indicate that the controls are not operating effectively. He has obtained some misstatements. He has detected some misstatements. See, misstatements have been detected. So this is a given thing that misstatements have been detected. Now, what the auditor has to do, he has to consider whether the misstatements which has been detected indicate that the controls are not operating effectively. That is the outcome of the detection of this misstatement. The result of this misstatement is that you have to doubt the controls, that whether they are operating effectively, because if they are not operating effectively, there is a greater chance that there would be a misstatement. So you have to examine that whether this misstatement is due to non-operating effectiveness of the controls. So this is something which you as an auditor has to consider. But not only this, even if there are no misstatements have been detected, that in this case you have detected some misstatements, so you are doubting the controls. But even if you have not detected the misstatements, that does not give you a guarantee that the controls are effective. That is, if you are not obtained, you haven't obtained any misstatements, that is in no case that is a it is never a guarantee that the controls are effective. So even if there are no identified misstatements, you have not identified any misstatements, controls may not be effective. Then if he has identified any material weaknesses in the internal control, you have to communicate with the management or those charged with governance on a timely basis as early as possible. That's a statement that the auditor shall communicate. This is something which the auditor has to do. He has to communicate material weakness. Because if this was a result of material weakness in the controls, you have to communicate these material weaknesses in IC refers to internal control identified during the audit. Now this is a single sentence, this during the audit on a timely basis to the management or those charged with governance. Management could be would be at an appropriate level. Right, so this is regarding the control test of controls. We have covered the test of controls in this. Now we are going to cover the substantive procedures. So now we are on to the substantive procedures. So first of all, we are writing down the definition of substantive procedures. Again, this is an audit procedure. As I told you, test of controls and substantive procedures are part of audit procedures. The definition is that it is an audit procedures. Again, it is designed to detect. The purpose is to detect material misstatement. This is MM means material misstatement at the assertion level. Right. Now, this substantive procedure these substantive procedures has two parts. One is test of details, as we all know about this. It is your examination of your transactions, the account balances and disclosures. So three things come in over here. Your transactions, account balances and disclosures. This all will be covered in the test of details. The third thing is the second one is substantive analytical procedures. Analytical is always as the term means analytics, always related to your ratios and trends. Analytical procedures, right? And now we are going to write about the There's some general statements only, it doesn't have anything, but about the substantive analytical procedure, so we can write that they're generally more applicable to large volumes of transactions, because when the volume is very high, going for test of details, this may not be effective. So you perform analytical procedures, you examine the ratios, you examine the trends, etc., and then you apply various formulas, etc., for examining them, or for detecting material misstatement at the assertion level. Now, first thing we have in this substantive analytical procedure is that irrespective of assessed risk of material misstatement, that is irrespective of the risk you've assessed as per SA 315, assessed risks of material misstatement, the auditor shall design and perform substantive procedures for each material class of transactions. The same thing, transactions, account balances, or disclosures. So we are not concerned about the risk which has been assessed. We have to perform substantive procedures, we have to design them for every transactions, whether there is a material misstatement in that or not, but it should be material though. I mean, not every transaction which is not even important. If it is important, whether or not there is risk or not, we are going to perform substantive procedures to those transactions, to those account balances, to those disclosures, right? Now, substantive procedures related to financial statement closing, when you're closing the financial statements process. See, substantive procedures which are related to financial statement closing process. So that is, when the financial statement has been closed, what you have to do, what the substantive procedures are going to include. Now, I'm using SP for substantive procedure because it has already been 52-53 minutes in the video. So substantive procedures shall include agreeing or reconciling. The financial statements. You're reconciling the financial statements with what? The reconciliation is always between two things. You're reconciling because, for example, you reconcile the your profit and loss as per the cost records and the accounting records. So reconciling is always between two things. You're reconciling the financial statement with accounting record. Accounting records are used for preparation of the financial statements. So reconcile them. That whether they are reconciling, whether it is appropriate or not, or you agree with the financial statements or not. So this is something, first thing which is included in the substantive procedures. And the second thing which is included in the substantive procedure is that you examine material. JE refers to journal entries and other adjustments which are made during the preparation, when you are preparing the financial statement. If there has been material journal entries or other adjustments during the preparation of financial statement. This is how you have to go. Let's examine the material journal entries. This is included in the substantive procedure which is related to closing of the financial statement. Right. Now we have a case that the auditor has determined a significant risk. There's a significant risk. The auditor has determined this because this is SA 313 which have an assessed risk. It's determined, and this risk, when the risk is significant, the auditor's substantive procedure should be responsive to this, specifically addressing this risk. So what the auditor has to do, auditor shall perform substantive procedures that are specifically responsive to that risk. Which risk? This risk. The audit procedure should be, the substantive procedure should be specifically responsive to this risk. Now, the timing of substantive procedure, you may perform it at an interim date, that is within the period, interim date, or you at the period end. But there's one more thing, attendant or period end. But when you're performing it at an interim date, the auditor shall cover the remaining period. That is, this is your audit period. If you're performing it over here, substantive procedure over here, your auditor shall cover the remaining period as well, because maybe in the obviously in the next visit, etc. But this has to be covered. I mean, you shouldn't forget about covering this. So this is regarding the substantive procedures. We're done with the substantive procedures now. Now we are on to evaluating the effect, sufficiency and appropriateness of audit evidence. Now, this is very easy. Evaluating sufficiency and appropriateness of audit evidence obtained. You have obtained the audit evidence. Right? You have the audit evidence. Whether it is sufficient or you have to obtain it more. Whether it is appropriate or you need to improve the quality. Who is going to decide this? It is a matter of professional judgment. It is for the auditor to decide this. Now, but what factors he is going to consider? It is like the significance of potential misstatements or effectiveness of management, the response which is being given by the management, whether it is effective or not, the audit procedures performed, the results, the sources and reliability, whether it is external or obtained from external sources or internal sources, etc. So yes, there are many factors which affect this, and you can watch my video on essay 500 for learning about your essay or about your audit evidence. But there's one more thing in this, a small case, and this evaluating the sufficiency and appropriateness of audit evidence. The case is that the auditor has not obtained, now the auditor has failed to obtain sufficient and appropriate audit evidence. What he has to do? What we do in IRC exams, attempt. So that is, should attempt to obtain further audit procedures. Sorry, further audit evidence. He should attempt to obtain further audit evidence. Given attempt, if you're able to obtain further audit evidence, fine, you're done with. But if you're not able to obtain or unable to obtain sufficient appropriate audit evidence, you have two options. Give a qualified opinion. If you do not know what qualified opinion is, you may watch my videos on essay 705, 706. Qualified opinion and disclaimer of opinion, or disclaimer of opinion. This has have been covered in essay 705. These two qualified, disclaimer is when you're not giving an opinion. Qualified is when there's a good discussion about that. It's a big issue as well. That when qualified opinion is in a way worse than your disclaimer of opinion, and adverse opinion is worse than your qualified opinion. So give it a try. Watch my video on essay 700. You'll get to know about this. Now the fourth, we're on to this. We're done with fifth. Now we are on to the last thing, that is documentation. That we are covering now. Documentation. The auditor has to document something. Documentation. It is always the end of the essay. Documentation. Okay. So what he has to document? The auditor shall document the first thing. That is the overall response. The overall response. So the overall response. He has to document that. What is his response to address the risk of misstatement. This is MIST means misstatement at the financial statement level. What is his response? Then your audit procedures, nature, timing, and extent. You have to audit document that nature, timing, and extent of further audit procedure. Then you have to give the linkage of these audit procedure, linkage of those audit procedures with assessed risk at the relevant assertion level. Then again, what results you have obtained with this? Results of audit procedures. Then about these test of controls, that is conclusions reached. About what? About the operating effectiveness of controls. Now there's a change in this. Conclusions reached in the present period with regard to current audit. In the current audit, you have reached a conclusion about operating effectiveness of controls that was obtained in prior audit. I covered a case on this, you must be remembering. Quite a few minutes back, I'll just show you. Yes, audit evidence obtained in previous auditor. You shall, if there has been any changes, test the controls in current audit. If there are changes, you can test them again. If there are no changes, every third audit. You have to document this. And conclusions reached with regard to current audit about operating effectiveness of controls that was obtained in prior audit. Then, last thing, form and extent of audit documentation. What we are documenting as of now, this you can say can be applicable to every single essay. Form and who is going to decide the form and extent of audit documentation? It is a matter of professional judgment of the auditor. Again, this is a matter of professional judgment, but so something is there that it is influenced by three factors. The first factor, nature, size, nature, size, and complexity. What is the nature of the entity? What is the size? What is its what, how much complex it is of the entity, and its internal control. It depends upon that. The documentation will depend upon this. Then influenced by also availability of the information, that is available easily or not available, all of them is available or not. Availability of the information is going to provide you from the entity. Right? The third thing is audit methodology. And technology used in audit. What methods you are using, what technology you are using. It all affects your document and availability of the information that you have obtained, easily obtainable, or you're able to obtain every information from the entity. The nature of the entity, the size, its complexity of the entity, its internal control, etc., is going to affect the documentation. And that's all in essay 330. Hope you like the video and subscribe to my video as well. Thank you for joining me. For the next video, you may watch, be on with my channel. Thank you so much.